Well, everyone, thank you for coming. Good evening. We're here to celebrate our 1-month-long exhibition, Colorscapes. It's a father-daughter duo. We are joined by both artists, as well as Frank Phillips, who we had exhibiting with us over the summer. So we're going to talk about their different styles, why they all came here together, and what Colorscapes is. So I'll hand it over to our artists, and thank you for coming.
I can start off, typically, you know, if this is a I hope it's a conversation.
Yes, it's definitely.
But, ideally, I would want to be kind of in the studios. I mean, I'm someone who likes to see not only the end product, but what goes into it, and like, even like what the room looks like, and how the things are spread out. I'm someone who really enjoys kind of every part of the making. Not necessarily like, I'm usually frustrated, but I like how other people always curious about how they go about their day, because it's all a different sort of journey. But I hope that we can, I'm going to ask you about kind of that as well in this conversation. But I'm just thankful that we're here and thanks for having me along.
Well, I actually asked, this is all my doing, and Frank is the nicest person on earth, because when I know that they've done Q&As before, and and then we sort of, I don't know, we've kind of tabled it for a second. I was like, can we circle back to the Frank idea? And then she must have asked you, so thank you so much. I'm so excited to talk about process and talk. I think we're all three of us are really painterly painters. I mean, and process oriented. And so I'm sure that our studios look different and similar in ways. Our materials that we use are different. Like when I found out you use only acrylic, it blew my mind. And also, like I should be headed in that direction. So anyway, that's me. Dad, do you wanna?
So maybe some context here.
Yeah.
Because it's not normal that you would have a father and daughter art show.
Yeah.
And so I was reviewing some files of my father, and I found this. Third grade, and I'll just start. So, I mean, first of all, I'm Tom West, but I was called Tommy. Now I'm adopting that name more because Kate's third child is named after me, and we call him Tommy. So, you're welcome to call me Tommy, and if you do, my heart bumps. Know what I love. So, this is really kind of curious because it speaks to some of our conversation. And this is
third grade.
In workshop, which is probably art shop, Tommy used wood, clay, and paints, all that he would, with equal interest. He loves to work at the drawing table and has experimented with unusual materials that have been made available to us from the construction of our new building. There's often a touch of whimsical humor in his projects. I read
so
that.
So interesting.
That is just beyond.
Awesome. Look what we have.
This is
on a
typewriter.
On a typewriter.
I think, Frank, we should adopt that.
I would like that.
Yes.
It's not my favorite.
So, ever so briefly, what that shows you is obviously I have had an early interest. And Kate, as my daughter, is watching me paint. And I, you know, to say at the studio was kind of in the roles because I was painting next to the furnace, basically.
Well, in the first house, we had a sweet house in Chevy Chase.
Oh, that's true. We had a little bit of a space.
You were painting there, too.
Right. What was fun is there was a show and tell at school in her third grade. And
true.
So I also have another side gig where I make money, you know. And so I could have gone in and talked about my side gig, but I came in as a painter. And I remember talking, and of course, Kate is terrified. What is he going to say and do?
Right. I don't think I was that
smart. Well, you were a little terrified. But what I did, which was kind of cool, is I talked about my process. And then I took a big roll of raw canvas, and I just rolled on the wall, and I just did a black line around the perimeter. And I had all these materials out, and I said to the class, all right, come on up. And they all went up there. mention the context. This has been going on for a long time.
The birthday party at the art farm.
On the birthday party.
I had a, what was that, first grade?
That was first grade, yeah.
Well, so I just want to say Frank has a daughter. Oh, so okay. he could be taking notes for all of them. I'm sure you've already done this, but yeah. We had the best first grade party where there's this thing called the art barn in Silver Spring.
Where is that actually in Rock Creek?
It's Rock Creek Park. Right. And we rented it out, I guess. And it's the same idea. There was a canvas on the ground, and you did a border, right. And talked a little bit about painting.
And that's also where I had my show.
And you had
it
was very
good. I had a show at the time, so we were dancing. But anyway, this so that gives you some little follow-up context. And so fast forward to this. This is the third time we've done this. But this is, I think, you know, the process and also the quality, and particularly in Kate's work, is just spectacular. So I'm sort of riding her coattails. I came on the ride. But anyway, please.
Take it away, Frank.
Yeah. Well, I mean, for me, whenever you have two bodies of work together, it's hard not to find the connections. I mean, whether it's a diptych or the same artist or but two separate artists. And for me, you know, I'm looking at the work and I'm finding sort of moments and passages and hints of kind of the way they're constructed. I mean, it's a mystery unfolding before you if you give it the time. And so, like I'm painting back there, where you can see that Cate may have obscured over a tree that maybe wasn't there, or whether you're seeing the pinks of some of these systems. I don't know, I mean, you call them grids, I think, but kind of these lines that are stacked and then, you know, pushed over with another color and then pulled back. It's a push-pull, adding, subtracting sort of process that it might be similar in its application, but it is different in the results. Even though I find it really cohesive to working bodies of work. And part of that is where you place things. You know, is there a moment of purple here and a moment of purple there? And I just think it's really...
That was intentional.
It works very well. It works very elegantly. So, I mean, I'm curious about how you go about it. Because I've seen Instagram, great Instagram here. But like, where you're working, you know, clinic and on site. And, you know, I haven't been, you know, back to Maryland for a while, but to know how you work and how, what's step one, and then what happens from there? How do you react to that stuff?
So for me, I guess going back to the history of my life, I studied all the way through high school, and then in college, or Princeton in college, I was still pursuing figurative work and certainly landscapes and so forth. And I had one professor took his class and basically he said, okay, here's your challenge. You're going to stretch a canvas that is your height. And so for me, that was 6 foot long. I'm thinking, wow, what am I going to do with 6 foot long? And he said, your width should be kind of your body width. He was trying to get us to understand scale. And then he said you could only use two colors. So I was somebody trying to be Monet, you know, all the colors in the world. And so, but what he did for me was all of a sudden it clicked.
Yeah.
And I stopped doing it, all the figure work and all that other stuff, and I just went right into the abstract notion, and this is sort of the result of that. So how I begin is I start with a active space, and that is usually lately been defined in a raw canvas or raw piece of paper, or linen, and I just draw the line. Like in this case, I just rolled the linen on the wall, and I just drew a black line, a thin black line, and then I just started using that as my active space. And then the frame grew from there, and then everything else came from there. And I'm not thinking about, is it 30 by 40 inches, or is it 6 by 4 feet? I'm just sort of intuitively starting. And of course, that created a real problem. Personal frame this because I didn't give them extra. So that's something I had to factor in later in life. But so that's kind of how I started. So that's the beginning stage. So why don't you?
That's good.
Right.
Yeah, you have a little bit, you also make studies and drawings.
Okay, yes. I mean, this from this piece, there are smaller works.
Always drawing.
You can see the studies. this case, I probably spent 3/4 of the time drawing, and then the last step was the three colors that you see down there. And I had to use real restraint because I didn't want to just put the color on there and then wipe out the grid and the pattern that I created below. So it took real restraint just to take the paintbrush and slowly go over those grid lines. And you can see how the grid is coming through. That's all intentional. You know, it's part of the process. And so I would say it goes in stages. First is the act. In fact, I wrote this in my little thing for the show. Starts with the space, the active space, and then I create a grid, in this case the grid lines that you see. Then I do the gestures, which is more chaotic, and then I apply the paint at the very end to really give structure to the painting and also eliminate the things that I don't think are appropriate or let things come through that I want you to see. So you can see where the more chaotic gestures, I'll let the grid line come through. So when I'm painting that, I'm making those decisions as I go. You know, it's not preordained. It's completely intuitive. You know, what shape am I going to allow to shine through? And then at some point, I feel like it's finished, and it takes real restraint to stop. And that's kind of that.
What I love is him using the word restraint, because I can't relate. having Paula painting in this show, and then the night after we hung it on a Wednesday, I brought it back in my car, and I continued to paint on it, framed, and brought it here and hung it with. So, but what's interesting about what you're saying is that, and Frank's work is very much this way, and he had a show he would call this. We all three are interested in pentimento, which is like having the journey of where you've been shine through and not covering up mistakes. And, you know, on the way here, I was like, you know, I should look up the 10 rules that Deepin Foreign had of painting, because it's sort of been my guide in my painting journey. And one of the pillars he said was, there are no mistakes. Wasn't that one of them? There are no mistakes, or you're not allowed to cover up mistakes, but you can make changes. And that is kind of, I would say my process is similar, or the ways in which my process is similar to that is that there are, the layers aren't meant to be sort of obscure. I'm not so preoccupied with that, and I don't know where I'm headed once I start.
You don't work from studies.
I don't work from studies in the same way. I juggle two different things. I work from life. Well, I'll start with my journey, and I actually got some books. What's funny is that, so while my dad has really been in this area of the active space and the abstract sort of direction, when I started painting, and I started taking painting at the school I went to in Washington, called Holton Armstrong, it's an all-girls school, and I had this wonderful teacher who's much like Frank, and his name is Lee Newman, and it was exactly the opposite. It was, you work from life, you do blind gestures, you learn how to render, and then you earn, maybe, the right to deviate. And I just fell in love with the whole thing. And I actually brought, so I'm coming home, and I had, do you remember my Lucian Freud days? What, how old was that?
Young. Young.
Ninth grade? Like, so, you know, we would always look at books before our class every time. And like, we were at the Phillips collection often at the class too, and drawing from, you know, Degas, Rembrandt, self-portraits there. And I remember discovering Lucian Freud, and that was kind of it for me. I was like, okay, this is how I want to paint. And his work is, you know, it's all about sort of the grotesque and these big, broad strokes. And so I kind of went in that, I mean, look at that, and I'm coming home, how about 9th grade?
Oh, yeah.
My parents are like, are you okay? But so I really kind of fell in love with that. first felt like I could start to abstract intentionally. And so I still do small studies. I plant paint sort of from life in landscape and still lives, which are the works I'm usually most proud of. And then I let those things dictate the larger works.
So I'm a...
How about you?
Gestures create a surprise for me, and if I'm surprised, I diptychs, where two planes are competing with one another. It's in that tension, these works down here, the tension you see between the two planes is where the active element occurs, and that, as the creator or painter, is either successful or it's not. And that's what I am striving for. And also I like nice colors. but that's so
well,
that's
that also, yeah, that makes that, the work
of people. So anyway, I'm sort of blabbing, but that's kind of an idea of how.
Well, I would say that I'm pretty preoccupied myself as well about where the eye travels and composition. In fact, that trumps color for me. The challenge of this particular show was the idea of using color for color's sake, which is, everyone's always like, I love your palette, and of course it's what I think about the least. The palette is just a means to get there, but I think it also, I take for granted maybe a natural sense of palette that I have intrinsically. But I'll just use this card as an example. Most shows you'll ever go to, the cards that you get, the paintings will look different in the show because I changed them from when the card is printed and when the paintings are on. So this is a really good example. I just realized this. I don't know if you noticed this. But so this is the card, and this is how it was. And I was so preoccupied by this area. It had gotten, I thought, I got really attached to it. It was this complicated. This is actually a golf course in my mind up on the East End that we go to in the summers. And I was really interested in using the Architect Fund and Natural Horizon lines found in a lease course that's carved out of the land naturally. And it's this wild, sort of juxtaposition. A natural landscape and then these artificial sort of flattened plains. And so, anyway, that was sort of what this was based on. But then I realized that this whole area, I'd gotten too attached to it. It needed to go. And now you can see I obscured it intentionally with this broad blue stroke all over it. So, I don't know if that answers your question, but I think by eliminating areas, which especially the places where I feel like that I think are too lovely, and taking that risk to make a broad space, because in fact it's better for the overall composition, especially in a larger work. It's all, and it's one of the things that I always respond to with Frank's work is that if you really look at it, it's really flattened, large planes. And it's one thing to like look at those paintings, but to actually paint such a big rectangle or such a big shape, it's nerve-wracking. It's challenging. It takes a risk. So anyway, I don't know if that answers your question, but for me, the element of surprise here would be this broad stroke covering a lot of intricate detail that also you can still see if you come up close. But I think I got it into a better area. Something I wanted to change here was this, like, blue plane. I thought, okay, I'm going to obscure that, and I left that in. Again, like, that was hard for me to leave in because it feels unfinished, but I think it's when things feel too finished that you know that it's not, I'm always constantly wanting to dip up. I want sort of unfinished and things that are rectified to close this
position. Yeah, I mean, I think that leave people wanting more. It's kind of that idea. And the worst thing you can ever hear is it's overworked. I mean, no one wants to hear that.
I think all of my works are overworked.
But I'm curious, it's called Colorscapes. And I'm curious about, and for you to say that that might be the one of the last things you think about. And I'm curious about the choice of colors that you both use. Tom, I'm looking at some of the work and how you're selecting both the sort of the scribed lyrical line that moves kind of vertically, versus the pattern, the meat, and then the blocks on top. And it creates this idea of where sometimes the lines seem to recede back,
right.
And sometimes they're standing out. Sometimes they're doing both.
Right.
And how you're doing that, and why you're choosing these colors. Right. And then for Cate, if you don't know what colors you're wanting to do, what's driving you towards those? Because they are meeting very kind of traditional landscape convincing, because I'm seeing distance. I'm seeing distance here very compressed. I'm seeing distance here very kind of long.
Yeah.
But so talk about the color use.
So in this example here, this sounds really stupid, but just random. I just happen to have these oil sticks.
No, talk about materials. That's something you want to talk about.
So the process here, these lines underneath here, okay, you see those individual lines? Those are oil markers, which are really just felt pens, but it's oil paint and a little marker. And they come in mostly primary colors, some more muted colors. And so that's the first thing I lay down, is I lay down that section of it. But one thing you can't see, it's very subtle, but there is a difference, because I also do a wash over that. So once I lay the lines down, then I wash them with different colors. So there are actually blocks here that are different. So I'm constantly thinking about the tension between one section of the paint and the other. So I do that wash. And then the next thing I did was the gestural thing. And the gestural thing is really just a piece of graphite. And I just went down and just did the graphite. And if you come up close, this is again the restraint piece, is, you know, somebody that wanted to have everything perfect would cover over the graphite line. They wouldn't want anyone to see how really kind of third gradish it was. Just this, but to me, that's the beauty of it, because then you can see the creative process. So if you come up here and you'll see the graphite line all through that, that's the next step. And then I just took these oil, what do they call it? Oil crowns?
Oil crown.
So oil paint and a stick. And that's what, I just went around the graphite line, and again, it was just intuitive as to how I would shape them and how I would stop from one section to the next. And how I chose those colors, these two colors I kind of knew sort of beforehand, and then I put the yellow in there, and then I went away on vacation. And then I thought for like 6 weeks, what am I gonna put here? I fretted about that color. And then I realized, well, I'm gonna pick up this green here, and I'm gonna use that to bring it in here. And that's how I decided on that color. But that's the process.
But you pre-mixed the color too before you...
Yeah, pre-mixed. So none of this, except for the oil sticks and the markers, these are all hand mixed. They're not out of the tube. So I'm just, you couldn't go buy them.
No. Nor would you want to.
So anyway, that's kind of...
The colors, this has been a unique show for me in that the colors in my work here, my dad's work was finished before my work for this show. Because you've been making these works, I would say, since we got the gig.
So 2 years.
Yeah, 2 years. And
so you were looking at them.
I was looking at them, and I am always preoccupied by the space in which the paintings will hang. And so I was already thinking about, well, what would look good? How are we gonna? And I don't think that's a very serious answer, because I think really a practicing painter is if you present what you're making. But I would argue that if you want a good show, you think about how it's going to be hung. And also, I think I probably was a little nervous about how our work would interplay. your stride in line that I sometimes rely on. So applying lots of thick color in layers and getting it to a place. And you know, I call it Colorscapes because in my mind these are planes of color, but yes, there is a landscape element to it. It's both there.
Yeah. And there are these gigantic windows. A lot of them, even the smaller ones, are being larger than they are. And so you are confronted with these vistas.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, they are
vistas.
They're bigger than you are, and you are kind of looking at it the same way you would, standing outside.
That's great.
You referenced blind contour. Actually, I think both did. And it's the first thing that most art teachers do in school.
Have you done it, Ruby?
you weren't in my drawing class, so you went from the
contour. That's true. I went straight to me.
It's okay. You'll do it in mine.
But it is my favorite exercise in drawing. I still do them every time with the kids. I do them on my own. And there's something so honest about a blind contour. I mean, most people I don't think can look here and look here at the same time. So you are having to obey in a way that the hand and the eye have to move in tandem. And if you pay attention to what your eye does and not what your brain thinks is a hand, if you're doing a blind contour hand, you actually look down at the end of that and you can push it and pull it together in your brain. And it does look like, skin on top of muscle on top of bone, and it's awesome. I love it. I love the way the kids do it. Even with that simple directive, they all still look like their own. Everybody's mark is different. It's a signature, for lack of a better term. And I see this as being almost a mark similar to a blind contour. And you referenced it in what you do to start out sometimes. So. I don't know if you want to comment on kind of that part of how you make.
So, I mean, for me, it's this idea of the creative process. It's defining the space, creating a grid of order, and then chaos. So I want there to be an element of chaos and gesture. And then as the creator, I come back in and I try to apply a little more order. I believe it's an expression of the human condition. That's why one of these series is called The Human Condition. You can see body, mind, and spirit, so you have three parts of your life, your body, your mind, your spirit, but each one is very chaotic and also very ordered, but they do relate to one another. So these three pieces are expressions of that. And everything that I do, I think, is in that vein, where you're creating order, chaos, and then you're applying the last order in a picture out of chaos to also be an intention between order and so forth. So that's kind of how I philosophize, think through abstract painting. It's not just abstract painting for abstract painting's sake, it's an actual creative process that reflects the human condition.
When you're human,
and
you're the creator. You keep saying the creator, I love it. I am gonna use that now. As a creator of my paintings. I couldn't agree more with you about blind gesture. I mean, I have been asked to do a couple workshops recently, and I don't know how to teach at all, so I'm glad I
did.
So I do the same thing every time. We do time, I get the timer out, because that's how I grew up doing it. Literally, with a timer that had, I don't know the timer that Lee used, but it had paint all over it. And we were doing blind gestures of like still lives, but then also the figure. And I started in seventh grade, and I did not know that was kind of wild to be drawing like a new figure, like, and to be sort of to normalize that. But then, you tell people that, and I'm like, what? And it just was, you need to learn how bones like make up a human body. There is a right way thing to measure, and there is a right way to render like what you're seeing. And but especially in an all-girls school, people are so attached to it, and that is what blind contour is. You're not allowed to look at your paper, and in France, they hit your wrist with a ruler if they come.
I'm curious. So clearly the work pulls together for both of you, and I think that any artist comes up with their own guardrails or own rules. Like if you were to walk in the studio and say, if I were to tell anybody in the room, it's like, make a painting. Just go in there and make a painting. You got all the colors you need, or get any size you want. That would be daunting.
Oh.
And so if I said, okay, well, why don't you make it, you know, 10 by 10? Why don't you use only a cool color palette? And why don't we have it be of that bottle right there? And make sure the bottle goes off out of the frame somehow. Then you've got some really good, like that kind of quiets the mind a little bit, and you've got some rules, but still enough to make it so that anybody here would make a different painting, a different drawing, a different whatever. So what are the rules that you all have for yourselves when you're in the studio?
I don't necessarily have rules as much as I have a process that begins again with articulating the active space and then sticking to that kind of abstract notion that we want to create a painting that has interest, that has tension, and whatever the tools are. And I guess what's happened with this work is I'm expanding my tool set to many more different types of marking apparatus. I mean, you should see my studio, it's just filled with markers. crazy things. Whereas, 15 years ago, you would see my studio and there'd be charcoal and paint.
Yeah.
So now it's just filled with all these different things about how to make markings, how to make drawing, the drawing aspect is so important. So I guess the rule is to just also stick to the concept. I usually go into a painting like this and I say, let's stick to the vision as long as you can, and then if it stinks, throw it in the trash. And I will throw away paintings. I've been experimenting with these oil markers, and I want to put a wash over them. And it took me a while to figure out the right viscosity of the wash, between oil and turpentine and all that. So I'd spend all this time putting these oil marks down, and then I'd do the wash, and it would all bleed.
Oh, gosh.
Yeah, that was not a good day. And that's when I just rolled it up. I just said, that didn't work. But that's part of the process. You have to experiment. So I would say being open to experimentation, but also trying to stick to the original vision is always important. Because I usually go into a painting and have a vision of what it's going to look like through the study process. Okay.
No, that's a good answer. My rules are different. I would say I'm much more fluid and much more, as you said, when you were saying the element of surprise, I think maybe what you meant as well, or I interpreted it this way, that I feel like I need to continue to feel surprised myself with the content. Like, this is why I'll never actually be that successful. I could never do the same motif over and over again. If I do something that's really exploring flat shapes and the figure playing, making the volume be less so, I immediately want to go take a figure drawing class. And over the pandemic, I did a bunch of classes. I did a figure drawing class, and then I did a class with my high school teacher at the Washington Studio School, just painting or drawing skulls and bones. And I think it's that rigorous, keeping up with my mark and doing that, and then having that muscle memory. Is that the way we put it? Like, that is there, that I'm making these drawings. And then when it comes to sort of making some of these larger works, I think that the size of the panels that I'm using probably dictates, and just making sure there's enough larger planes of quality paint, so it's our Bible, but I think that nothing is saved in my studio. I will go at, I'll paint over anything. So yeah, that's my answer. Okay.
What's my favorite color?
No. One of the things I'm struggling with is we both are oil painters, and Colorscapes especially, this is what's revealing to me at the show. I'm too fast a painter. I'm too probably lazy, if I'm being mean to myself, a painter. And my parents think this about me too. Completely. They're like, oh, how long did that take you? But I think that there's part of me that, A, this is how I learned, where you have to just get it down, you know, like get something fast. But that I don't pre-mix, you know, I'm working live with a live palette and trying to, you know, get there. But I need to take more time so my colors get muddy. I'm not washing my brushes in the same way. And I think that there's something tricky about oil paint. When did you move towards acrylic, or have you always worked with it? Because your paintings don't feel like acrylic paintings. You can see the sentimental in a way that I only thought you could achieve with oil.
I think that...
do you realize you use this acrylic?
So the acrylic for me, it's a couple... reasons for it. I mean, help, like.
We
need ventilation. I think that I needed my paint to dry fast.
Okay.
And having tighter quarters for both the ventilation, but also being able to kind of move things around. And I like to work on a lot of things at once. And also attacking the surface with sandpaper, with pencil right away. Scribing back into it when it's a little wet and thinning out with water. And so I use water to thin, but you know, to get it a little more sort of liquidy, and you know, sometimes I'm working up, sometimes I'm working down. And I mean, what I like in all the work is that, you know, a brush stroke. I mean, we're painters for a reason, because
yeah.
We like what paint does.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a record of speed, intentionality, and all the things that we want it to be, and I like that. And I don't know if this will wrap it up, but like, it is in all the work. I think you mentioned it's a human experience, or like it is what it is. You know, I think everything we do is a self-portrait, and I'm by no means perfect. And I think that the work shouldn't be perfect. I think I like that it shows mistakes. I like it shows where I need to nudge it over. I need to nudge it over more, or I need to kind of correct this. One more time, you know, add, subtract, add. So I like that it's a living thing, and to a degree. But the question here is, when do you stop? When do you guys say it's finished?
When the opening.
Oh, right. So I heard something recently at a presentation like this, where somebody was presenting as an artist, and the interviewer asked the artist a question. And he said, well, I remember when I was, he was older, and I remember people were in a class and somebody would do a painting and they'd say, well, that looks like a really bad de Kooning painting. Because de Kooning was sort of the hot artist at the time. You know how he is. And the guy said, well, you don't get it. Only de Kooning can do a bad de Kooning painting.
Yeah.
And I just thought, that is perfect. That's the ownership. You know, that's where the artist does have ownership. And then it also separates you from any other artist. You're not emulating any other artist. You might be influenced by those artists, but it is your work, and it could be bad, but it's not a bad de Kooning, it's a bad Tom West, or whatever. So
yeah,
anyway, that was
good.
A very helpful thing.
That's good. Yeah. So I think in high school is when I discovered, thank you for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you, Courtney. Got the same exact linen stretched canvas, because I thought, how are we going to link our So I've shipped this very expensive panel to your house.
Right.
And I was like, just paint something on that, and I'll paint something on that, and at least it will be the same size. but for me, oh gosh, where do you start, right? I love what you see in his work is he's dividing this square. It's probably actually not a square. No, it is. This is only 13 inches. Hmm. All right. No, inch. Inch.
Yeah, inches.
So he's dividing this square in such a major way, and I'm really interested in combining still life, landscape, and interiors all in one. And I don't know how you do it, but it's one I'm interested in. And I think, yeah, I started getting interested in Dean McCorn in high school and college. And he just had this way of painting. I first, of course, loved his figures and his still lifes that were, you know, he was able to, like, in a couple strokes, get
a fork or a knife.
Right, a fork or a knife or a glass. And he's working with such confidence and intention. But you see here what I'm doing in some of the small floral settings, which is, I really got back to doing these floral settings during COVID when I couldn't go to my studio. All I could do was paint the peonies from my yard. And I actually did a still life workshop in my backyard that Ruby went to. Do you remember it? And I thought, we'll just record what we see. But anyway, I think that's when I got into it.
So a little anecdote thing. There was a major retrospective.
Yes, that's another thing.
At the Corcoran
Thank
Gallery.
You for bringing that up.
Before the Corcoran, it was the last thing the Corcoran Gallery had, and then it closed. But it was this major, huge retrospective of Dean McCorn. And so Kate came up and said, we gotta go to the Dean McCorn show.
I was pregnant with Tommy?
Cattle. And so she came up and we went to the show, and at the time I was doing this test. I was doing these works on cigar boxes. So we're going through the show, and then we turn the corner, and we look down in the corner, in sort of the left-hand wall, all of a sudden these huge works and these small works, because he's massive in terms of his scale, we go over there, and there was a whole series of paintings on cigar boxes.
And that's what started it for you, right?
Well, no, I think it was important for her, because she realized, that's like a sign, I better, because you weren't really painting.
No,
yeah,
I was ready for Christy.
Right, it was like a sign for her that it kind of, validated that what I was doing was not crazy.
That's true.
He would paint on a Partagas box, and I would only paint on a Mac, H.O. No, but he would paint these, and actually the story goes is that they got a hold of them, but they were all in somebody's collection because they were personal things that he would do with personal friends. And he would just do these things.
I have an out-of-print copy of all of them, like, book. I'll lend it to you. Frank, this is for you, from me. Thank you so much. This is I did it in Batesville, one of the workshops. So, I think you made me heart it. He's so supportive on Instagram. When I get a heart from Frank, I'm like,
show us.
Oh.
the interesting thing about the cigar boxes, and we should probably pull Ruby up here because in our class, I asked a question the first day is, if you could own any work of art ever, what would it be? But the rules are, you can't sell it, you can't sell tickets to come see it, and it needs to fit in your home. And I pick a different one every year, and 1 year I did pick a cigar box. Another year I picked next year would be a Tom. And then the next year I think I picked ones that were, $8, which I love. So different styles and different things like I mean, we're informed by the things that we experience, and we tip the hat, and we hope that we're not trying to replicate, and I think that nobody here is doing that, and it's just trying to move forward.
It's what's cool about painting is it's a lifelong vocation. So there's no, like, you have to get it now. Like, this
Jeez.
Well, I'm actually looking at Lois Dahl, who's like my, newest favorite painter. She gets her, I found out she gets her paintings done in one sitting. Or Lucian Freud, who I realized I thought his paintings were done, frantically and quickly, but he spent 20 minutes before he put one mark down. And that was totally not how I thought he constructed his paintings. And then this documentary came out about it. And anyway, the art of seeing, learning how to see, is really what we're talking about here, in my mind. To always be looking. You're painting all the time, whether you're painting or not. Like, if you've seen Frank's little drawings, that's a great evidence. He's always, keeping a notebook. And if you want to look at other painters, I would say the first thing you should say is, where are your drawings? That's what I'm interested in always.
And then also, if they're an abstract painter, we're saying this, if they don't have drawings, just move on.
If they're an abstract painter,